Blackstone Audio presents Freeing David McCallum, The Last Miracle of Rubin Hurricane Carter by Ken Klonsky. This book is read by Keith Sellon-Wright and Prentice Onayemi, members of SAG-AFTRA. This book is dedicated to the memories of Rubin Carter, Ken Thompson, Larry Hoffman, and Willie Stuckey, David's co-convicted, who died in prison in 2001. Introduction. If you're giving up on something, what you're really giving up on is yourself. Rubin Hurricane Carter, 1937 to 2014. My childhood was encompassed by a history of segregation and unmasked brutality that has abated but by no means disappeared. Most of my family and friends disapproved of segregation in the United States. But as some of us Northerners later discovered, we were scapegoating the South to cover our own sins of exclusion. In Rockville Center, Long Island, where I lived as a child and adolescent, the African-American population lived in Lakeview, a census-designated place, CDP, located adjacent to our town that few white people ever saw. Back then, its inhabitants provided a workforce for menial jobs and domestic help for the white families of our town. My family and many of my friends' families had black maids throughout the time I lived there. Most of the maids came to work via a local bus that made its way up Hempstead Avenue. The only other passengers on this bus were young people who had yet to receive driver's licenses. Rockville Center was divided into three religious groups that had minimal contact with each other: descendants of the original Protestant inhabitants who founded the village, Long Island's largest Catholic diocese with a Catholic hospital and a Catholic school, and a sizable contingent of upwardly mobile Jewish families to which I belonged. The main property in the village was a golf course, the Rockville Center Country Club, now Rockville Links Club, an immense fenced-in area that sat in the center of the town's upper-middle-class neighborhoods. My father's generation did not seem to mind that Jews were excluded from membership. The situation was accepted as a fact of life, and the cost of residing in a privileged community with highly respected schools and artesian well water. Kids, myself included, used to climb over the very high surrounding fence and damage the greens and fairways. We resented the exclusion, even if our parents did not. One summer in the mid-1960s, I worked as a security guard and was dispatched to various places in Nassau County. My second assignment, for $1.79 an hour, was at a small public housing development in Lakeview. I wore a dark blue uniform and carried a nightstick, my outfit closely resembling that of the local police force, which was viewed unfavorably by the black population. Given all I knew about policing, I might as well have been wearing a Halloween costume. No one threatened me, but I don't doubt now that the uniform made me a potential target. One hot afternoon, two kids were having a serious argument. A long knife was drawn by one and sunk into the shoulder of the other, passing through the skin with no more resistance than through a stick of butter. Appalled and extremely frightened, I left the premises, billy club in tow. I called in the incident to the police but never bothered to find out how the wounded boy had fared. Soon after, I tried to convince a local reporter to investigate what I presumed was a volatile situation in Lakeview. He expressed interest in the story but dropped it soon after. I suspected that the paper didn't want to stir up a hornet's nest. I requested that the security guard agency find me a new location, resulting in a two-week stint in a bone-chilling supermarket in Long Beach, where one day I confronted a woman for stealing a pack of chewing gum. For some reason, maybe a growing consciousness of social inequalities, witnessing the petty theft and intervening in it felt almost as bad as witnessing the knifing. In 1967, when I moved up to Toronto to attend graduate school, I came to an understanding of who I had been all those years: a white liberal whose actions failed to match his words. Reading Eldridge Cleaver's famous quote from Soul on Ice produced no small amount of discomfort. If you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. Perhaps the phrase, like so much in those turbulent times, was too categorical. Doris Kearns Goodwin, the famous historian and biographer, wrote an autobiographical book in the 1990s, Wait Till Next Year, about growing up in Brooklyn and Rockville Center. Goodwin, then Doris Kearns, had gone to the same high school as my siblings and me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.